Okay, so now the combiner has a talk, and somebody has to control my time. Okay, so I just want to emphasize the possibilities that are within the study of geodiversity as a tool. The concept of geodiversity, that is the measurement of the diversity or the geological diversity. In this case, with it's a case example I will show at the end, but first I have some basic concepts. The concept of geodiversity was developed, as you know, very recently in the 90s, after the geodiversity, I mean after biodiversity concept. It's analogous to biodiversity and has suffered some of the same problems with reference to the elements or not to the diversity and so on. And there's several definitions. Generally, it just covers the variety of elements, so it's a measurement of the variety of the diversity. And it has to be always specific of a region. You cannot talk in general, because it depends on what you are talking. It will be high, or you will have low diversity or high diversity. So it's always important to specify where you are talking about. So the what specific scale also, and also the limits of the area that you are referring to. Normally, for the characterization of geodiversity, and there has been several theses, PhD theses and studies, and already published in some journals about the study of geodiversity of areas. Of course, as I was mentioning, they define very clearly the size of the area to be studied, what types of features will be considered, because you can have, as I was mentioning, different scales, the diversity of minerals, of fossils, or the diversity of geological units, geomorphological, paleontological, or only tectonic units. So it needs to be very clearly specified, the thematic areas that will be dealt with, and also the different indexes that can be used. There has been from other areas, not just the earth sciences, there has been from other areas the development of indexes to study diversity of elements, and these are being used. So the idea is to define the variety, frequency, and distribution of these geological features. That's what will define the geodiversity. So variety, frequency, and distribution. Variety means how many different classes we have. So on the left you have low variety, on the right you have higher variety. So you have more classes, less classes. That's the variety. The frequency, how frequent they are found. In the left you have very frequent, one class that is very frequent, and others that are less frequent on the right. So it depends on the frequency, depends also on the times that you find one thing of the same element, one class. The number of times that you find each of those classes, and then you have the distribution. Even if you have the same variety and the same frequency, you may have different distribution, how they are distributed, the geometry, the position they have. So even if you have the same variety, you may have the same frequency, the distribution will also change the diversity, and there's lots of examples about that. Okay, so it depends on how they are, and this is, there's very nice examples with formations. You may have thick bands of a unit or thinner bands that crop out, or dunes that are very simple lithology in an area, but then it may have many different elements. If you are looking at the different dune shapes, for example, so it depends on what you are, on the topic that you are looking at, the sand composition, the dune shape, or whatever. So that needs to be specified, and also, as I was mentioning, the area where you are doing this study, because an area on the side may have very low diversity, and the other one may have very high diversity. So it's important to not confuse the terms geological elements, geodiversity, and geoheritage, and to choose to use the proper term if you want to refer to the variety of elements, not to the elements, but to their variety, then you use the term geodiversity. For example, there's all territories have geological elements, okay, but then there's territories with important geological elements, that's the geoheritage, that may have very low geodiversity, as it says there. There's territories that may have high geodiversity, and no important geoheritage, because there's it's all very common and no problem about it. But it's still maybe having a high geodiversity. And there's also territories that may have low geodiversity, that may have more or less geoheritage than others. So, I mean, these things, there's two concepts, two different concepts. What's important? The geoheritage. What tells you about the variety? The geodiversity. here are some examples. The one you see on the left is a stratotype of the Jurassic. It's just a slope, it's not very beautiful, but it's of huge importance for paleontologists who want to study the evolution of ammonites, because that's the type section for one of the periods in the Jurassic. No, there's lots of scientists going there, paleontologists, to study, the ones that study the Jurassic, of course, the Jurassic, the Dogger, Malm, the Malm. And so, for paleontology, it would be high geodiversity, but for lithology or for geomorphology, there's nothing, not much to tell, to say about the geodiversity there. So that's what I mean, and then it depends on the area. So you need to specify clearly the scale of what you're looking at for the diversity, and also the area. And then it may be of high importance or low importance that will make it a heritage or not. So geodiversity is an intrinsic property of the territory. It may be high or low, and depending on what you refer to. And at the same time, an area, a big area with a lot of geodiversity, as Vic has mentioned, provides a lot of different habitats, opportunities for different plants and species and animals. So, or bacteria. So it depends on the. So that's why we consider the geodiversity, having a high geodiversity in an area, is itself of value. So that's why it needs to be preserved when there's a lot of geodiversity, because it allows to allows for the resilience, for example, of species, because they can find more available niches than an area that is very just plain with very low geodiversity. Okay. So I think it should be clear difference between geoheritage and geodiversity. In geoheritage, we look at the value in geoheritage, and in geodiversity, we look at the variety, frequency, and distribution. And then we want to preserve both of those. That's the actions that are taken in geoconservation. Okay, so now we look at this example. This is in the Pyrenees, in an area that is itself a geopark. So this area you see on the left with colors, what's black is not sea, it's just France is to the north, and there's other regions that in Spain that are not geopark, that are to the left and right. This side of the area is another province of Catalonia, and this area is another part of the same province of Huesca in northern Spain. So here you have the location there, okay? And there's these formulas that are used to analyze the diversity of elements in an area. And there's different methods of calculating this variety, this diversity, and similar to biology. And in this case, the authors of this work is one of my colleagues in the Geological Survey of Spain, and also from the University of Aragon in northern Spain. They use this semivariogram indicator that tells you about the diversity index. And in this case, the study was very simple. It was just analyzing overall lithological diversity. So, for example, slopes or facing north and south or other aspects were not considered, just the what's called the chronolithological units. Okay? So we use this geostatistical descriptor to map the geodiversity. And it can be used as a tool for protected area management. That's the idea. So this is the map that came out with different geostatistical analysis, with a bigger or a smaller. This is with not the one on the left with non-overlapping division into cells, and the one on the right when they are overlapping and moving window. So it gives a finer control. So what you see here is areas with higher geodiversity with these chronolithological units are more green, and the areas in black or red means that they have very low geodiversity. So what happened with this is that This is all a geopark. This is a natural park. This is a national park, number 8. That's another natural park. This is another natural park. So there's two natural parks, a national park, and then all of those are within a geopark. There has been an inventory of geoheritage, but as I said, that has nothing, I mean, it has to do, but the important thing in analysis of geodiversity is the variety, frequency, and distribution of those units in consideration. In this case, it's the geochronological units, the Cretaceous limestones, Cretaceous sandstones, Jurassic, whatever, and so on. And then you can see that between the national park and this natural park, there is an area that has very high geodiversity that has not been included in either of the protected areas. This area is mostly just limestone. It is a beautiful area with very nice karstic caves and many karst features, but it's very simple geochronological units. Of course, if you analyze the geodiversity of the karstic features, then it would be very high geodiversity for that kind of features, but we are not looking at that. We're looking at the diversity of overall geochronological units. So the idea here is that there's a possibility, because there was an analysis of what areas could be expanded in future protection within the geopark for corridors, for connection between protected areas. And that's what this, when it comes, a very useful tool, because we have already identified potential areas that have lots of different niches for the habitats development in the corridors to connect those two protected areas. And that's what we said here. So there, in this case, there had been a proposal to connect the natural parks, but there was cities and roads, and there it was more difficult. And also the geodiversity was less. But then in this area that has higher geodiversity, less roads and towns, and there's more possibilities for this area for development. In this case, the geodiversity can be used for the planning and management of protected areas to identify potential zones that can be protected. And that's about it. So just to emphasize what I mentioned in the beginning, the proper use of terms and the possibilities of using the geodiversity index maps for protected area management. Thank you.